in the second asking, is it the whole is greater than sum of parts or sum of parts is greater than the whole?
So sum of parts will not give you whole, in the sense that the whole is always greater than sum of its parts. That's possibly the better way of saying it. I think I should correct that. Maybe so. You should say the whole is greater than sum of its parts. Just say sorry for that question.
How about leader-led disorder?
Okay, so only thing that I would say is that leader-less disorder is possible, but for that you have to spend a lot of energy and all the taxpayers' money. And one great example is the current Aadhaar system. You know, a huge amount of money has been pumped in to bring in that disorder. And all our, in fact, there is a network interpretation to that. In fact, I always keep it in my Twitter because I really love that. The more you link, the more Aadhaar database will leak. So the linking is directly proportional to how many links each one of us do to each of the other things. Like you link it with mobile, you link it with the bank, you link it with whatever. The network theory tells you very clearly, the more you link, the more it will leak. And that's what is happening. You know, so you have to pump in a lot of energy. On the other hand, I know him. Okay. So if he can trust me and I trust him, we make a link. Okay. And then I come to know that I know Vikram as well, and Vikram also trusts me. So I build what is called web of trust. Now, web of trust is already something like 25 years old computer science topic that all of us we used to use, and most of the geek community sign each other's public keys and create a web of trust. And if you really want to create identity which is identical to social identity, that is the way we should be. Just because computers are capable of doing something, we should not promote the mafia linkages to happen more and more, because that is actually going to be working against our systems. So the network theory actually tells that what is being done in India, for example, today, which is not done elsewhere because people have repaired themselves. Like Europe has rejected it, London has rejected it, many other people have rejected that we don't want that kind of system. But India wants to do it because, I don't know, whatever reason.
India is great.
India is what?
Great.
Oh, yes. Very, very. Really. Yes.
So, why did you equate anarchy with disorder?
Did I? Hmm.
Yes, you did. And when you were explaining the term leaderless order, you didn't say it, but you implied that anarchy was, in fact.
No. What I wanted to actually say was that lack of a leader, which is what we mean by anarchy, right?
No. Anarchy is lack of hierarchy.
Well, but also it means that there is no hierarchy, would mean that there is a leader, right? Because it flows from there. The people's actions are flowing from the directions of that thing. So it is in that sense that there is a leader in hierarchy. Hierarchical system is a leaderful system.
Right, and anarchy is the opposite.
Anarchy would mean that there is no leader.
Yes.
Yeah, that was my interpretation, and that's why I used that model.
But you also implied that it was therefore disorder, and yet, then you said, but
despite that, you still get ordered systems. That's what I meant.
But it's not despite that, it is in fact that.
Leaderless.
Okay. Yeah, but it needs to be worked out. Yeah. Because it's not straightforward, because, you know, just like any other science, this is also a counterintuitive theory of science. Because it's quite counterintuitive for people to believe that without a leader, order is possible. But the network theory complex systems actually tells us that order is possible without a leader. Yes. I don't know if anybody is looking at who is raising who. If you want to check it out, I'm just, whoever I am seeing, I'm just asking them.
Oh yeah, so I should thank you for the fantastic talk.
talk that you have given. I mean, it's a coherent whole, but I have two doubts here. So one of the doubt is a metaphysical one that you said about ship of Theseus, right? I mean, if the whole relationships are intact, and what about the identity? I mean, that's a philosophical question. I'll keep it aside for a while. So the other thing is that it so happened that I was fortunate that I worked with Stuart Kaufman and David Wolpert and Gregory Chaitin. So one of the lack of organization in that is that Stuart Kaufman always tries to get the ontology from critical systems, right? And on the other hand, people like Gregory Chaitin and all information theorists, they try to say that information is at the fundamental level, and they try to somehow blow it up and get all the macroscopic order and all of that. So both of the approaches fail fundamentally, because there is some sort of a metaphysical glue that is needed to bound all of that in the ontology scheme, right? And so the only new breakthrough that will result is from some sort of a philosophical guy like you, who is into biology and physics and all of that. So one of the doubts that I had was that what are the various entities that you consider in your ontology? Because this is a great way of looking at it, but you need to specify, because everything has to be tied to logic, right? So Quine said that everything can be reduced down to sets. That's his indispensability argument. I don't know if you're a Platonist, but somehow all of this should be grounded down to some logical structure, nominalism, intuitionism, whatever it is. So what sort of a scheme that you order in your ontology for all of this to work? Like, what are the elements of your ontology? Maybe use Occam's razor and just give me a basic description.
Well,
that
so,
is fantastic.
I mean, it's a very deep question. And I would only say the following thing, that in my ontology, which is made of nodes and links, okay? And I would begin there.
Okay.
So, is to say that I would interpret the world as a network.
Okay. So you have a meaning in terms of those things, because meaning,
that's
intentionality,
right?
And
so,
many
so,
other features.
So in fact, Quine, you already cited Quine. So Quine is one of the first persons to propose a network theory of meaning,
mm-hmm.
Where he actually very clearly says that our language is like a core and a periphery, and the linkages are like that. The meaning of the terms which are at the core usually doesn't change, whereas in the periphery they are more subjected to change because of whatever perturbations and cultural changes and things like that. And so he also says that if something changes at the core, you almost get a paradigm shift kind of thing, you know, in the sense that, you know, it will become a kind of a revolutionary kind of shift and understanding that. So but then the coin has only one core.
Mm.
But today we come to know that, you know, we may not have multitude of cores, but we have countable number of mini cores. So the multitude is a very important aspect in my ontology. So I would never think, for example, that there would be one ultimate building block according to this model. The building block has to be many. It may not be infinite. It could be a finite number of countable things, but it has to be many.
Some sort of an ontological pluralism.
It is an ontological pluralism, but it's not ontological infinitism.
Oh.
Okay, so you're basically saying that you need multiple things to be the nodes. That means you need multiple kinds of nodes to begin with, in order that the variety can be generated. So my ontological toolbox will have that kind of multitude. Okay, I'm very happy that I will now be able to connect to Stuart Kaufman with only one hop. If I want to send him a mail, I'll now pass it on through him. So that's the way how the world is so small.
Yes.
Yeah.
So you told about the numbers, right? If I take the example of the birds, right?
Mm-hmm.
Suppose we are taking 2000 birds and we are getting that pattern, right? Now, if that is an event and we can repeat those events like 1000 times, so each time will we be getting the same pattern that we get the first time? The patterns will not be same, right?
No. It will not be the same pattern. But By looking at it, you will not think that you know, they are behaving differently or something like that, because it's a school nevertheless. It's a school of birds, you know, moving from one place to the other together.
So there must be a flow by which you can track the change of the pattern.
Who changes it? Who looks
like
at it?
Like the school of the birds, they're changing their pattern in the course of time, right?
But the problem is that each of them are not seeing the whole. Each bird sees only its neighborhood.
Alright, they cannot see, but
you can see the whole pattern.
So is there any structure by which you can track the change of the pattern, how they are changing it?
Yes.
Can we define after
That is in fact how the simulation is done, right?
So maybe he's asking, what do you have any quantity with which you are you asking something?
But quantity. Suppose if I am trying to track that pattern, can we determine after this amount of time we will be getting this specific pattern? If the flows goes like this,
no.
Can you predict?
By the way, so there is one thing that I must say. We may be able to explain in new science. New science doesn't promise any prediction. You may be able to understand how events are happening, but it doesn't really predict only this pattern will come.
Okay.
Only that pattern will come. In some cases, maybe you may be able to predict if you know the system very well. Maybe if you have already done it a number of times, but it's only a kind of very general predictions of patterns, but not specifically. So in fact, it has also been stated a number of times that the initial conditions, even if you know, you would not know what the final outcome would be.
Okay.
It's
random.
So because it is in that sense, it's a nonlinear kind of system. It's not a linearity. You know,
there
is no
question.
Classical
system.
Sir, in that sense, when you're talking about it being a very complex system which ends up in a very different destination from what we expected to in the beginning, do these systems end up having attractors like the Lorentz attractor for randomness?
Yes, they do.
To which they seemingly seem to converge, or sets of convergences that they have.
Yeah, in fact, that is how the order actually begins. The order begins by some center of nucleation, as in crystallization, for example. So, you know, until that point when the nucleus in crystal is formed, you won't see anything in the liquid. But suddenly, as and when it happens, you immediately see crystals emerging. So that is almost like an attractor. And some people are actually of the view that you can begin with the homogeneity, okay, then the probability for heterogeneity is very high rather than probability for homogeneity in the kind of system. So even if some three things happen to come to, let's say, suppose if you divide the entire space into a grid of cubes, there is a likelihood that in one cube some 10 systems will automatically come due to whatever random reason. The moment they come, then they might become the attractor. Because rich becomes richer, right? That's the rule. So, and therefore, it will immediately start attracting, and then an aggregation will happen there. So attractors, but there is nothing like only this will become the attractor or that will become the attractor. You won't be able to predict in what corner of that space that attractor might emerge. That will be difficult to predict.
So, but then how does this translate into thermodynamic stability? When it comes to thermodynamic stability and... So
to that I will give a metaphorical answer. Take water. Okay. So water has, according to the formula, H2O. But actually speaking, the liquid water is not really H2O. There are not just the covalent bonds between oxygen and hydrogen, but there are hydrogen bonds. Okay. Now, so they do all the magic for the liquid water, being liquid. The point is, the reason why I'm saying, so if it is a covalent bond, it is not broken while the molecule is intact. But if it is hydrogen bond, what actually happens is that they form and break at a particular order, at a particular rate. But as an observer, you will not know any change is happening like that. Right? So the weaker things are actually the ones which are doing it. Now, now water is a thermodynamic buffer, a heat buffer, right? Which is almost like saying that if we add some temperature to it, it's not immediately getting hotter or cooler immediately, in the sense that it holds whatever it has for a very long time. The reason being that it is no doubt that adding some heat will break more hydrogens, but at the same time they're again formed at the same rate, and therefore you will not be in a position to immediately recognize that there is any break in that kind of system. So in that sense, what happens is your thermodynamics is not a trouble in a system like this, because people can easily explain thermodynamics of why water is a better buffer than the other. Just that we haven't taken account of those weak links called hydrogen bonds.
As a philosophy question, you said basically, okay, if you take emergent properties and you say that the whole is greater than the sum of the parts, isn't that like at some epistemological level, isn't it defeatist to say that, okay, we cannot probably extrapolate? So the strength of reductivism is that you can take any particular phenomenon, however large it is, and you can condense it into some set of postulates which allow you to sort of have access to more of the universe than you can perceive otherwise. So if this is the new approach itself, then suppose, okay, we understand something, say, about planet formation or within our solar system. But then if you just think of it as a system and then you try to extrapolate it to another galaxy, then you don't know if the same thing can happen with a new number of nodes. So how do people treat that? Is it considered as some kind of sand in your shoe that you don't want to ever think that you can't extrapolate anymore?
I would actually look at it this way, that I'm not one of those philosophers who take classical epistemology as something that is etched on the stone. I belong to a school called naturalized epistemology, where we don't mind taking lessons from whatever is happening. In fact, a large number of original epistemology has been now replaced. For example, today there is nobody who would be a radical rationalist or a radical empiricist. We have a new breed of empiricists, a new breed of rationalists, and who are not of the same kind. But interestingly, what actually happened now is that we are, in a sense, being celebrating greater understanding, rather than less of it. Because earlier you said that, I don't even know that area at all. I don't know why it is happening. Or otherwise what you did, you added intentionality to that system. You attributed intentionality to that system. Or you attributed the leadership to that system. Or you attributed control to that system. Or you attributed some kind of a management to that system. But today we are only coming to know that there is no such hierarchy in that order. So, knowing that, in fact, if you look at it in a general schema, as a model, for example, hierarchy can be part of a network. It's a subset, because I can actually make directional graph, like a Bayesian graph or something like that, and you will see that hierarchy is part of that. You'll very clearly see that transitive relations happening. And therefore, you will be able to make hierarchy as a part of it, but you can't do it the other way around. That is, you cannot build networks out of hierarchy. Why? Because in hierarchy requires that you can't have more than one parent. Whereas in a network, that's a possibility. So, therefore, understanding this model actually gives you that you are now in a better ground. And I would actually say that hierarchy can be reduced to network rather than the other way around. If you allow me to use the word reduce for the time being, though I'm not a reductionist. So what I would do is I would actually reduce atomism, reductionism, to this network model. Because if you look at it, I deliberately used the thermodynamic system of, and also the inertial system in the world. Why I'm saying that's actually coming from the old classical science. But you can actually even interpret that as a limiting case of the network model. So which means that this model is not suffering from any kind of lack of explanation. In fact, we are able to explain much more than what we were explaining earlier. I'll put it that way.
So what you say about leaderless order, is this restricted to order in terms of certain things? Because when we see nature, so many examples of hierarchies and leaderships, even what we see in society, you do have a leader set for most things. So if leaderless order is possible, then why do natural systems not evolve that way?
Actually, the point is that most of the natural systems do evolve that way, but not maybe social systems to some extent. In the following sense that in the social systems, you can maintain a hierarchy, as I said earlier, by spending a lot of energy. You know, like for example, you know, I'm sure our Prime Minister must be sleeping less than us. You know, he has to bother all the time, you know, every small nitty-gritty thing he has to worry about. Because, and then he's not alone, there are a lot of people who are spending a lot of money and time and things like that in order to maintain whatever they think they could maintain. It's also an illusion, right, that they wanted to maintain that thing. So what I'm trying to say is that, I'm not saying that hierarchical systems are not possible. Hierarchical systems are possible provided you spend a lot of energy. So, on the other hand, if you form a large number of small networks, you know, as people like Gandhi have talked about, and people like, who is that, who talked about small,
Shoemaker.
Yeah. So, those are like systems which are networked locally, everybody knows everybody, and there, you know, you don't have to spend too much energy. Even if you have small hierarchy, you still don't have to spend too much energy there, because it's a kind of a nice, small, distributed whole which can be sustained with less amount of energy. So the point here trying to say is that if you want to maintain a hierarchical system, the system has to spend a lot of. I am using the word energy, but it could mean
resources,
finances, it could mean time that people spend, whatever.
So in follow-up on that question, I mean, even though there's not a specific leader appointed, you still have there's a general consensus that this guy will start the initiative, or this guy will guide the hierarchy, right? So let's say a community or a group is there. So unless every player in that group tries to get his own optimum or his best output from the decision that the entire group made, he's going to be dissatisfied, right? He's not going to be satisfied, right? So let's say, in a UN assembly, there's no leader to mediate between, or in this talk, let's say there's no NC to mediate this talk, wouldn't there be chaos? What do you think? So there must be, unless everyone gets his own, so there's no leader, so unless everyone gets his own best output from the...
See, actually, unfortunately, I have to do this the following way, because you know, here I am touching on that issue on the second and the third and the fourth chapters of this work, because you see why? Because you see, we are intentional, that means cognitive systems, right? So the cognitive systems are the ones who are reflecting on themselves. So first of all, we have to ask this question of how is it that this complex system is reflexive, which means that how do you actually create a system which can touch itself? You know, reflection essentially means that, you know, you can reflect on yourself. So the possibility of that is being discussed in the third chapter, where I'm actually trying to see how that sort of works out. And it is only when we add, we are not saying that intentionality is not there in the world. Of course, intentionality is there in the world. All of us are evidence of that. We all have intentions. We all have plans. We make design and things like that. We are designing creatures. We interpret. We do all those things. So we have to somehow try to understand that within this framework, how is it that such systems are actually possible? And so, so that is being worked out as a separate chapter altogether. So unless I actually build that ontology, it will be very difficult for me to answer straight. But I really do not have any problem, because I have to also explain how leaders are actually possible. In the sense that, you know, there are leaders, of course. Leader is a fact. But may not be in all parts of nature where we want to impose anthropocentrically. Right? So the places where there is no leader, if we put a leader, then it's a mistake. If there is consciousness in me, and then you say that there is no consciousness, that would be a mistake as well. We have to somehow explain consciousness. How is this intentionality or consciousness is actually possible from one of those complex systems that are emerging out of that? So that's where the evolution of complex systems is being discussed from that point of view. I don't think anybody could really work out everything perfectly, but we just have to make an attempt to come out with alternate models to work out these things. Maybe next year, this month, I will possibly come back again and talk about that chapter.
Half a question. Suppose there was no person like him. You think that there will be a chaos here?
Well, interestingly, it would not be for one interesting reason, that all of us are rule-following people. all of us, you know, why are you sitting facing me? I mean, you should have sitting facing outside, or why are you actually even here? Why should have gone out? Right? So we are already come with that assumption that, you know, we are a rule-following people. So we start following some rules. So therefore, we also have to ask this question, what is it to be a rule-following creature as well? And therefore, even if he is not there, I think something would have been possible. We could have sat in some adda and met for chai or a beer or whatever, but that is still possible, right?
So can I give an alternative? I don't know if an alternative thing might work. So if I was not there, somebody amongst us may feel the need to MC this session for the amount of chaos that ensues, and they would stand up and take my place.
So that's like autopoiesis kind of thing. Autopoiesis.
So sometimes having a leader may be the natural course that a system may take. Needless of having to drive it. We'll come back.
I wanted to ask if a leaderless system takes a larger time to stabilize, than a system which has a leader. Suppose he was not there, so like we might be for some time in chaos, that rules gonna enter the system, something like that.
I would say that suppose if a leader is like a catalyst, let me use a metaphor. Would a catalytic reaction take less time or more time? Or less energy or more energy? Based on our understanding, they actually decrease the energy barrier of the reaction, right? So that's basically what happens when you have a catalyst. So it is in that sense, leader in a kind of a complex structure is essentially somebody who could possibly create that kind of a rich node where a lot of work gets done for lesser amount of energy, effort, or whatever you want to call it. So that's the way I would try to understand being a biologist.
I think it depends on the context. It depends on the context of a system. Sometimes having a leader may favor, sometimes not having a, working as a team or having a leader.
But we don't have to take any of this too seriously. See, we are fine. See, no, I'm trying to say, because you don't misunderstand me. just because I said that, you know, there's a new science and the old science doesn't work, it's not that the old science is there, that means that I am completely opposite to the old science or something like that. There's nothing like that. See, we have to throw some net to catch some fish. And then what you have to possibly do is, you have to maybe reduce the holes of the net or increase the holes of the net depending on whether you want to catch the bigger fish or a smaller fish. So, in a sense, our theories are like that. You know, we have to keep trying and attempting to see what we capture. Every net will not capture everything. So, somewhere, in the same sense, maybe even the network theory doesn't capture maybe everything. Maybe something else is already there somewhere else. Maybe some other model might come up which is better than the network theory.
But is there anything wrong? Just interestingly, when you said something, is there some kind of problem that is kind of somewhat intractable to network theory in some particular case that you tried to explain but has not actually been solved to a satisfactory extent?
I know, I have to do some homework to answer your question. So, I took note of that, but I'll just see if that is actually the case.
Just an answer to that. Is in fact you can see it in human society, is that we go on appointing leaders when actually we can see that it is self-destructive. And we've got to the point where we have 7 billion human beings, because we keep on putting leaders, even though we can see sensibly that 7 billion is far too many for this planet. And we don't have a way of this planet yet. So we have allowed ourselves to get to a very dangerous situation for our species. Which is self-destructive, it is not a very positive kind of thing. So we are choosing some solution, that leadership solution, which looked very logical when it was small and doesn't apply when it's very big, and yet we go on doing it.
She has a question.
Yeah. I want to ask if networking is equatable to communication, in which case a smaller group would actually communicate better. So how do you account for the multitude factor here?
Network, there are communication networks also, right? So the network could be of many things. So what are you saying? That the smaller group would communicate
be able
more
to
efficiently.
Communicate better. Yeah.
More efficiently. So would that mean in terms of the quantum of information, or in what sense?
Definitely the quantum of information, because it's objective.
Mm-hmm. Take for example.
When we speak about the internet connections of the world, they're essentially for better communication.
Let me use the other idea. Suppose that a small group, it is very unlikely from the probability point of view to have variety of ideas. Suppose if there are 2,000 people or 20,000 people, like the internet for example, that you take. What would happen is that there is a possibility that everybody will think very, very differently, because they come from different contexts. One is coming from village, another is coming from urban area, another is coming from a rural area, some other person is coming from some other place. One is in Boston, the other one is Mumbai. So a lot of difference, right? In terms of the context, the climatic conditions are different, you know. So as a result, the variation advantage is very high. So what I would say here is that whether the number is small or not, but the quality of interaction of that communication would be very good if it is a diverse community. So I mean, if you want to celebrate diversity, that is good. But if you are like a small peer group with nowadays the kind of academic journals that we have, you know, the I scratch your back, you scratch my back kind of thing, and that's how the publishing happens. So then they're not really asking for variety. So it's a small group, and they link up with each other, and then they produce something, and they think that, you know, they're actually doing science. But actually speaking, they're not celebrating variety. So therefore, in terms of innovation, creativity, and things like that, large groups are better. That's the way how I look at it from the communication point of view.
So Rakesh had a question.
In the simulation of bird talks, so if we change, like if we externally disturb few points inside that, so will it regain the order or will it eventually go to disorder?
Well, actually speaking, why don't you try this new parameter in the simulation yourself? Because I haven't thought of adding this myself. It could decrease. I mean, that's what he says, but I haven't sort of. But let me tell you, this is one greatness about all these things. They are very easy to even program and change the parameters. So all that you could do is add one more initial condition and then start the simulation all over again, and you will see the results clearly for you. So why speculate on these things when we have such an empirical toolkit in front of us? So we should actually do this experiment and then find out.
So it definitely matters how big your disturbance is, but given the size of your system and how close they are, how dense they are, you can actually predict exactly how big a disturbance would disturb at the entire block, and lower than that, disturbances would.
Because every bird is only one neighbor, so if
we
disturb even one neighbor,
most of these systems have certain parameters, and for different parameter regimes, these systems behave differently. So for a certain parameter regime, it may be sensitive to getting disturbed, and it may get disturbed more and more, and just run away, or it may come back and. So it depends on the parameter regimes of the system. Then, like most non-equilibrium systems, they have different phases.
Can we link it to the disturbance being like a school of fishes being being attacked by a predator, shark or something like this? But in that case, the order sometimes increases. Like they form a circle in the form because they want to escape from the predator.
All this can be quantified, but you saying a sentence and me saying a sentence doesn't mean anything here. When it can be quantified. So it can be quantified, but more or less order is a number when you talk about.
It depends on what sort of disturbance is active on the system.
So I can't say if that will be more order or not. I don't know.
Let's do it and find out.
Yes, the simulation is relatively easy.
Yeah, the simulations are easy to do. Let's do them and find out.
Further questions?
For wrapping up, but coming back to the title of the office and question, okay, fine, matter does not matter. And essentially, if I can say, okay, we learned that, okay, we have networks and you have particular rules of interaction, but the rules that govern each node, or the rules that each node governs itself by, whatever you want to call, aren't those then the properties of that node, which is how you define matter in one sense?
Okay.
So,
yeah.
Isn't it?
Yeah, I see where you're leading to. So, if I have to be a consistent network theorist, I have to say node is nothing if there is no neighborhood. Okay? So by virtue of the other nodes, only that I have become a node.
So, even the property.
So essentially, what I'm trying to say is it is like, you draw a line, you draw another line, and there is a point. Okay, what exists is just the line, the relation, the link. So the node is, I would say, apparent. It may not be real. I'm using the word may not be real. So it is in that sense that I would give precedence to the line and not the point. Okay. So, the point that you mentioned, of course, is that you asked, so the only thing that I would possibly say is that matter doesn't matter, but multitude of matter matters, is also the point that I made. Okay, now, that is also important because if you really want to have a network and a neighborhood, multitude is a prerequisite. So it is in that sense that I'm talking about. So it's very difficult because I would like to take it. I mean, if there is one thing that I can't doubt in this world, and that is multitude. Because I mean, whatever I see appears second time, third time, fourth time, everything is available to you. There is nothing that appears only once in terms of the type. There is nothing like one type for which there is only one instance. Theoretically, they're there. In fact, in philosophy defines them as single member sets and things like that. But you have never encountered them except in abstract models. So, if I have to rewrite a section or the title or something like that, then I would possibly try to put it in a different way. So the multitude of matter matters. Because that is when the whole ontology begins. Otherwise, there is no ontology. Let me say one important thing. You know, many people do not realize that one of the first persons who actually took multitude very seriously is a biologist, and his name is Charles Darwin. Okay, he talks saying that give me a population, give me a variety in the population, I will be able to solve this problem. His starting points of the axioms are beautiful. And I mean, there's no wonder that, you know, the evolution of complexity and things like that were handled by him so well. And today, whether it is Stuart Kaufman or some other complex theorist or somebody else is trying to see, they're all trying to see, you know, how do you make sense of Darwin from this perspective rather than throwing him out or something like that. Because his starting point was brilliant. And also the statistical reasoning and probabilistic ideas that he talked about. And then later on, of course, people have used mathematics to work on population dynamics and things like that. So in that sense, you know, he is actually thinking in a very mathematical way, a biological problem. It's a very interesting, and it is in that sense again, you know, it is the species that matters, the population that matters, not the individual. Evolution is not a change of an individual. It is not like metamorphosis of a caterpillar into a butterfly. That's not evolution. That's an ontogenic change, not a phylogenic change.
One last question. Sir, I would like to say that when you go from philosophy to actually building stuff, right, things get a lot more tricky. Like in the sense that, take your heart example. You said that you can just replace your heart with a pump. But in reality, it won't work. A pump will like apply constant pressure. But your heart, the pressure varies. That matters.
I mean, see, I'm not an expert. If I really have to meet a person who do this, I would keep asking it, because you know my heart beats at from 60 to 120.
All these things.
Almost every day. I don't know whether the artificial heart also does the same thing.
But I think to be safe, you must actually very carefully like reproduce the way the real heart works.
Right. Yeah, that's right.
But if you go beyond that, like if you want to say that I want to make a brain immortal, let us say, you will just replace all the biological matter with silicon. You preserve the relationships. So then any person can say that I made somebody immortal.
But
it won't work again.
No, it won't work because the person hasn't understood what is life. Because life,
no, even if you do
life doesn't work like that.
Even if you do and did understand all that, what I'm saying is that the way actually neurons work, right? And the way the silicon works, you must like exactly like reproduce the relationships happening in what you call neurons in silicon. But I don't think it'll ever work.
It may not.
So
may not.
Technically,
it may not for so many other reasons that, you know, you actually thought that this is what it is. But it is very likely that there are other functions that it may be as well performing. So you thought that this is the role that it does, and therefore you replaced it.
Yeah.
Okay, in the case of heart, maybe it worked, but it won't work for others in the same way. You know, maybe people have replaced bones and then they're happy about it. But I don't think everything can be done like that. Because, I mean, we know very well that neurons not only just, you know, do the connections and firing, they also secrete a lot of hormones and things like that. So, you don't know. You know, if you really have to replace that neuron, you also have to produce a gland there to secrete the hormones as well and things like
that.
Same
neuron.
Right. So it's going to be complex. I would say, yeah. Let me put this point very clear. So what is it that matters there is the functional role of whatever that is. Okay. So I would bracket that substance or that thing. I would say whoever could play that role will be able to fit there. So it's a functionality that we have to talk about. It's a role that we have to replace. So the possibility of, for example, you know, I think, let me give the other example, which is, I think, much better. See, the best evidence for the biochemists that, okay, now I know that we have cracked the DNA quite well, is when people actually have made artificial sequence. And not only that, they made artificial sequence, and that they actually, when that artificial sequence went into the cell, it started behaving dynamically just like any other micromolecule that was not synthesized artificially. In the sense that even though it has not undergone the same kind of metabolic reaction, but it was synthesized, let's say, in test tubes or whatever kind of thing. But it started playing exactly the same role, like the other one. Like people have actually produced insulin artificially and then put to see that, you know, whether it has the same role to play. And it did play the same role. So these are some interesting evidences to show that what is important for us, of course, is not merely that particular thing, but if it is capable of playing that role, only then it would go there. Otherwise, you will not be able to do it there. And let me just play the joke that don't take the title seriously. It's just to provoke people. It's just a provoking kind of thing. I mean, I don't think matter doesn't matter. Of course, it does. I mean, so the question is only to deal with that kind of. Pardon?
You are still a materialist.
Am I?
Let's say the title is not material.
Well, yeah.
We came here for the talk, not for the title.
Okay. I take it. Can't help it. Okay. Any more tomatoes?
Okay. So for those of you who'd like to ask more questions, we have tea and some snacks lined up.
Okay.
Which is just right in front of this room. So please continue the discussions there, and once we have had our tea, we'll be coming back here once again to have the meeting about the March for Science. Thank you for coming.